The most common class of quantum error correction codes are stabilizer codes. For these codes, error information is gathered by executing so-called parity check circuit, as you see on the slide. For some of these stabilizer codes, one gathers information about X and Z errors separately. In such a case, one uses two types of circuits to gather error information. One circuit is for Z errors, shown at the top, one other circuit for X errors, shown at the bottom. For example, we can have circuits which look at the parity of a subset of 4 qubits, as you see on the slide. Now, if any of the qubits has a Z error on input, the ancilla qubit will be flipped at the end, heralding the error. You can verify this yourself. Similarly, to detect and correct an X error, one can use the circuit at the bottom, whose ancilla qubit is flipped on output when any of the incoming qubits has an X error. For the Steen code that we've seen, there are parity checks on 3 subsets of qubits. These subsets are colored red, green, and blue. For each subset, there is a parity check for detecting and correcting X errors, and there is a parity check for detecting and correcting Z errors. Hence, there are 6 checks to be measured in total. Now, a parity check circuit is made out of gates which can fail themselves. For example, an X error can happen on the ancilla qubit after the second CNOT gate. It could be that the CNOT itself produced this error. And this X error causes the control of the next 2 CNOT gates to flip. The effect is 2 extra X flips on 2 of the data qubits. If our code was not made to correct these 2 errors, then this is really bad, because it took only 1 fault of that CNOT to cause 2 errors. It didn't look like we're making anything better. We then say that the circuit is in fact not fault tolerant. It cannot tolerate any faults in its execution. And to do quantum error correction and get an improved error rate, we only want to use fault tolerant circuits. And so only with fault-tolerant circuits can we make the logical error rate smaller than the error rates on the constituent qubits. So let us now take a deeper look at the surface codes. Shown on the very left is the distance 7 surface codes with 49 qubits. There is a qubit on each lattice site, it's not drawn. Now each black square represents an X parity check between 4 qubits, detecting a Z error. Each white square represents a Z parity check, which similarly detects X errors on the 4 qubits on which it acts. At the boundary of the lattice, the parity checks involve only 2 qubits. The distance of the code is 7, since the logical operators of the logical qubit act on at least 7 qubits. You see the logical operators on the slide. The defining feature of the logical X and Z operators is that they mutually anti-commute, but at the same time they commute with all the parity checks. You can verify this yourself by using that X and Z anti-commute when they act on the same qubit, otherwise they commute. Shown on the very right is the smallest interesting surface code, which has 9 qubits and it has distance 3. Now, to execute the parity check circuits for the surface code, we add ancilla qubits to the data qubits, as you see in the slide. The ancilla qubits can be placed in the middle of the plaquettes so that they interact via CNOTs, via controlled knots, with the neighboring data qubits. Now, one quantum error correction cycle is the execution of these parity checks. Okay, so X and Z, here you see X and Z errors on the data qubits are detected by the parity check circuits. You see the ancilla qubits are colored blue when they detect an X or a Z error. Since there can be faults in the parity check circuits themselves, as we discussed, these are not the only errors. For a small surface code, such as the one shown, fault tolerance of the parity checks can be guaranteed partially by repeating the parity check measurements. Such repetition is certainly beneficial when faults lead to incorrect parity check outcomes. For example, the parity check outcome heralds an error where there was no error, but just a measurement error at the end, or vice versa, it doesn't detect the error. The goal of preserving a qubit in time with surface code is now to apply many quantum error correction cycles and deduce the parity check outcomes from the parity check outcomes what errors have taken place. The logical failure probability of the illogical qubit is determined by how well we do this. Now, we can imagine using larger and larger surface codes with distance 3 and up. If the error rate on each gate is below some critical value, the error correction process, these error correction cycles, they improve with larger D. Namely, what we see is that the logical failure rate will decrease exponentially in D. However, if the error rate on each gate is above some critical value, then instead, error correction becomes worse with larger D. The whole error correction code makes errors more likely rather than less likely. The critical error rate per gate is called the noise threshold. This threshold depends on the method of processing error information, and it depends on what type of errors we have. It lies somewhere between 0.5 and 1% for the surface code. Thus, in order for hardware to benefit from the use of surface code error correction, it means that idling steps, single qubit and two qubit gates all have to have an error rate at least below 0.5%. Reaching error rates this low or lower is thus an important target for qubit hardware. We are currently on a long and steep road towards fault-tolerant quantum computing. And on this road, there are many steps and milestones. In this MOOC, you'll see some operations and small algorithms implemented on physical qubits. Then a next step is to try and store a logical qubit using quantum error correction. And the idea is to store it for a time which is at least longer than any of its constituent qubits. So far, experiments at several labs have shown how to detect a single error using a four-qubit code, and how to store a bit, just a regular classical bit, using three or five qubits. Now, experiments to implement the smallest nine-qubit surface code are currently being planned. In other words, it has not yet been shown experimentally that with more and more redundancy, a logical qubit can have a longer and longer lifetime. Now, once we store a logical qubit, let's say that's successful, we can apply schemes that let us do single and two qubit gates on these logical qubits as well. We have many schemes, theoretical schemes, available for this. This means that once we have logical qubits, we can envision running quantum algorithms on these qubits. And if these qubits, these logical qubits, have low error rates, the quantum algorithms can be long and hence realize a powerful quantum computation.